top of the 30% Club and Oliver Wyman, welcome to our discussion today, Women in Finance in a World with COVID-19. I'm Rupal Kantaria, a partner in the Oliver Wyman Forum and in Oliver Wyman's financial services practice, and it's a real pleasure to be your moderator today. We're hugely excited today to have global leaders running multi-country institutions across the financial services industry who are at the forefront of change. And they'll talk openly today about what they're doing to drive gender balance and specifically about the impact of COVID on that challenge, not only in their organizations, but also in their customer portfolios and in the industry more broadly. Quick housekeeping before we kick off. We will be doing some live polling, for which you'll need to be on a laptop or an iPad. So if you are joining via another device like a phone, please consider switching now. Also, you can follow along with the discussion on Twitter with hashtag WomenInFS, and we very much encourage you to do so. I'm absolutely delighted to introduce our esteemed panel today. First of all, Amanda Blanc, Group CEO of Aviva. Secondly, Anne Cairns, Executive Vice Chair at Mastercard and also Global Chair of the 30% Club and Chair of Ice Clear Europe. Some of you might be expecting to see Alison Rose, CEO of NatWest. Unfortunately, Alison was called away at short notice for a regulators meeting. We're absolutely delighted to welcome Inez Murray, CEO of the Financial Alliance for Women. Thank you, Inez, for stepping in for us. We're really excited to hear your perspectives today. And last, but definitely not least, Naveed Sultan, Managing Director and Chairman of ICG Institutional Clients Group at Citi. So before we hear from our panelists, thank you for your patience, panelists, I'd like to get our audience engaged and involved straight away with a poll that should have popped up on your screen there. So given the COVID-19 pandemic, what is your view on the current industry approach to driving gender balance? Are we doing all the right things, but we just need to stay focused? Are we pointed in the right direction, but we really need to speed up? Or do we need a radical rethink and course correct? And as the participants are polling, I'll just mention that we do have the chat function open today. So really encourage the audience to put in your thoughts, comments, questions, and I will be following along and try and draw that into the discussion. And we'll have a look at that afterwards. And it'll feed into something that we'll write up afterwards. And I think this question is interesting as we just wait for you all to select your choice, because there's been a lot of discussion on the impact of the pandemic and the disproportionate impact on women, mostly negative, but there's been much less discussion around whether the current industry approach needs to be refreshed, whether we need to be changing things. So Sarah, I think if we've got a decent number of responses, if you could launch the results. So that's interesting. We have a majority for our second one, which is we are pointed in the right direction, which is encouraging, but we really need to speed up. And I think this is a great basis from which to hear from our speakers on what are they doing to make sure that we're speeding up in their organizations. So Amanda, Anne, Inez, Naveed, thank you again for making time to prioritize this topic. I'd like to think first of all about the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on women in the industry when we think about women as customers. Very few financial services organizations would say that they prioritize men over women, but yet we see that men make up 60 to 70% of customer portfolios. So Amanda, I'd love to come to you first. Post-COVID, how are women's needs as customers changing? And how do you think about gender in customer service design?
Okay, so I mean, I think we have to be a little bit careful here because obviously we aren't allowed to discriminate between men and women when we price in our financial services products. So I think, you know, let's take that to one side. But I think the important thing is if we think about the pandemic, women have actually been disproportionately impacted by what has happened. Because if you look at the areas where women are employed, the part-time areas in hospitality and retail, that they are disproportionately impacted, and therefore the economic impacts on women are going to be more severe. I mean, and I think that's for sure. And what Aviva have done there is really look at how we can think about things like premium deferrals and how we treat all of our customers who are impacted so severely. The other thing that we've done very specifically is actually around domestic abuse, because we were very conscious that this could be an increased risk during lockdown, affecting women in particular, although of course not all women. But we developed a new domestic abuse policy where we trained our frontline staff around, you know, vulnerable customers to recognise some of the signs, and we did that with the Saves Lives charity, which we thought was a really, you know, really positive thing to do out of obviously quite a difficult situation. So those are some of the things that perhaps we've thought about in relation to COVID. But just to go back to the poll, I think there is some really, you know, there is a real need to accelerate, because clearly what we see from a customer perspective, women versus men, is that, you know, 60% of women have never calculated whether they can afford to retire. And, you know, that's versus 45% of men. So we know that there is this 40% pension gap between men and women. And I think that that is something that, you know, really needs some very, very careful thought, because, you know, that means that later lives for women are a lot more difficult potentially than they are for men. And I think the other area is around, you know, how do we think about ESG? Because we know that women are definitely more interested in ESG, but actually they are less likely to actively choose their investments when it comes to a pension. And so there's clearly a financial education point there that we need to think about. So I think that, you know, for us at Aviva, that's really what we are thinking about at the moment. So I'll keep it short, because Rupal, you told us we needed to be short and sweet. Hopefully that was good enough.
That was more than good enough. And
thank you.
Amanda, talk to us about what are the challenges there. So when you look at trying to reach customers, obviously with the fact that you legally can't price differently for men and women in the insurance industry, what are the challenges? What are you struggling with when you think about how to most serve your vulnerable customers, the majority or many of whom are now more likely to be women than men given COVID?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's about thinking about how we approach it, the words that we use, the terminology that we use. And, you know, there are very subtle things that people, you know, much cleverer than me can think about in terms of even the way that we just present our products, present the website, you know, that we make it look like it is more inclusive. And so that people really think that actually this is something for them. So for me, this is a lot about how we simplify what we do, because, you know, sometimes financial services may be accused of being a little difficult to understand and a little bit complicated and not very transparent. And I think, you know, we really have to think about that and the way that we approach that. That's not just for women, you know, that's right across the piece. We really need to think about, you know, how we deal with this. And if we look at COVID has really impacted the lower socioeconomic populations. You know, if I think about the mortality rate is twice as high in lower socioeconomic areas than it is in more wealthy areas for down to COVID. And, you know, if we think about other areas like flooding, we know that when people are impacted by flooding, they're more impacted in lower socioeconomic areas than they are in more wealthy areas. So it seems that all the sort of really difficult things happen to the more vulnerable customers. So I think that we have to be very, very cognizant as financial services, and particularly as insurers, about how we therefore position ourselves and make ourselves simple, straightforward, and approachable. Because a lot of people don't think that insurance is for them. They think it's too complicated, you know, that's for other people, but not for them. And that is particularly, you know, some recent Aviva research showed that women particularly feel that.
Well, I love that idea of, yes, we need to accelerate, but the way to accelerate actually is to simplify. So Inez, I'd love to bring you in and get your perspectives as well. You work with banks and insurers across over 180 countries, specifically supporting them to serve women, and really focused on women as engines of growth for the economy, which I think, you know, growth is really few and far between at the moment, growth opportunities. So what are you seeing across that portfolio of financial services players as the actions that they're taking and also the challenges that they're highlighting?
Sure, thanks, Rupal. So we've run weekly webinars for the past 22 weeks with our members on their responses to COVID, and I think there's two major trends. The first is the acceleration to digital. So we've seen across members an incredible increase in the number of digital banking customers and the use of digital services. And I'll just give you one example of why that's so important. So our member in Pakistan, Habib Bank, is the largest bank there, over 20 million customers. They've seen a 50% growth in digital banking this year, 95% growth in digital payments between March and September versus the same period last year. But in fact, what that's done is brought an awful lot of women into the bank as customers, because in that cultural context, mobility constraints, et cetera, make it pretty hard to walk into a branch without having somebody beside you. So this digital acceleration is really important. And in turn, because you need an ID to get that, that ID gives you the right to have a passport, to have a driver's license, to own property. So there's lots of unintended consequences to this kind of bringing more women into the system. If we then go over to the UK and across actually loads of other countries, we've seen a tremendous support for women SMEs. We've seen loan moratoriums, reduced interest rates, loan guarantees from government. So if you look at the UK, for instance, the NatWest team told me yesterday that in February, they had earmarked £1 billion for women-owned SMEs through 2025. And as of a couple of weeks ago, they'd unlent £700 million to women. So that's a 600% uptake year on year, and supported over 40,000 women SMEs in the UK through the various kind of financial and non-financial services. So you're seeing that across the world. I think there is something to be worried about. However, just latest research from, for instance, Westpac in Australia, 36% of women SMEs are concerned about their financial security, and 24% fear having no work-life balance. And that actual kind of in the 30s, we're seeing across consumer research, a percentage of women that are concerned. So a survey in August of 8,000 women in eight countries, including five European countries, showed that 36% of women are reporting higher levels of stress and fatigue in relation to their professional work. And the same percentage roughly are concerned about financial independence and their financial security. This is correlated with falling purchasing power. So while I think the sector has done really a huge amount to support women, I do think that you know, we're not through this by any means, and there's still a lot of vulnerability out there, as Amanda has said.
Anne, I'd love to get your perspectives on this. I know Mastercard is doing huge amounts again to support women, and specifically earmarking funds for women. But you know, in light of that vulnerability, like, what else do you think should be done, or what's in the pipeline from a Mastercard perspective?
Thanks, Rupal. Well, you know, first of all, just to hook on to what Inez has said, you know, we've seen a massive digital revolution this year, and it's been so big that in the first sort of 10 weeks of this year, we saw a spike bigger than we've ever seen in the last 5 years in terms of digital payments. So that's happening across the world. But what else is happening? People are going online to buy goods and services, and therefore SMEs particularly are struggling to be able to sell online, to set themselves up, to protect themselves from cybercrime and all of these kind of things. And we've seen in our surveys, which we did across 58 countries, that women-founded companies, and there's about 111 million of them around the world, women entrepreneurs, they are having a greater struggle. They're disproportionately affected. And about one third of those are telling us that the burden of care is actually hurting them in their business.
So we thought about this. We have a big program for SMEs around the world. We committed to bring another 50 million of them into the financial system as one of our goals through to 2025. And in the normal course of business, about a third of those would be naturally run or owned by women. But we said, why leave it at that? Let's level the playing field. So instead of going for that third, we're actually going for 25 million women-led and women-owned companies to bring into the financial system globally. And that means educating them, to Amanda's point, because, you know, financial services sometimes look opaque, difficult to understand. And not just education, but providing digital platforms for them, providing connectivity through to banks, providing them with data services so that they can actually get loans from banks using empirical data, because in many cases, women don't have the collateral that they need to get bank loans in many parts of the world, because they're not allowed to own things like property. So we're actually very much in this space that Inez has described, and working with the insurance companies and banks to get that reach into financially include women entrepreneurs, as well as women consumers, of course.
It's great to hear, Anne, about, you know, what I hear from you is there's been a lot of transparency, simplicity put around how Mastercard is applying a gender lens. So we're not just hoping that it balances evenly between men and women, we're actually putting that gender lens on specifically. And I'd like to move us on and bring Naveed in as well. So as well as the huge opportunity and challenge that we have in effectively serving women as customers, we also know that women as employees, particularly in the financial services industry, represent a huge opportunity. And between Mastercard, Aviva, and Citigroup, over 250,000 people are employed. And if we were to include the Financial Alliance for Women's members, I'm sure it would be a lot more. So, Naveed, Citi earlier this year appointed a new female CEO, Jane Fraser, to lots of excitement to many of us, men and women, in the industry. Citi were one of the few to voluntarily publish your gender pay gap. And you know, the organization in general has really led the way on transparency. And I'd argue that we actually have, you know, leaders here who are at the very top on transparency, showing, you know, the difficult gaps, the difficult gender pay gaps and where we're behind as a route to really being honest and driving gender balance. So I'd love to hear from you, Naveed, around what are the biggest challenges that you see at Citi as you're starting this real push for transparency and for change when thinking about women within the organization?
Thank you, Rupal. Let me make a broader point before I get into specifics at Citi. I think to my mind, it's inconceivable that any society and economy can realize its potential and work for everyone without embracing diversity in all its shades, and particularly gender, because women are half of the humanity. And accordingly, I think social and economic systems, workplace policies and approaches need to be designed by focus on women, their needs and requirements, rather than by focusing on men as human default, which has been historically the case and remains to a very large extent the case today. So I think it's extraordinarily important that the reference point for designing workplace policies, or for that matter, policies and approaches to customers are focused on women rather than men as a reference point. So as far as Citi is concerned, we believe we are taking a very thoughtful and systematic approach to promote and build diversity, including gender, at all levels in the organization. And in order for us to achieve that, from recruitment to training, development, promotions, policies and procedures, compensation parity, workplace design and facilities, these are all focused on promoting the diversity, including gender. So I'll give you an example. For in September 2020, we announced about a $1 billion worth of investment in strategic initiatives to help close the racial wealth gap and promote economic mobility. Similarly, several other initiatives are underway to support women minorities, social entrepreneurship across different regions and countries around the world. And in terms of the representation of women, we have published it externally that we want to improve the representation in at all levels in our organization. So at minimum, by the end of 2021, our target is to improve the representation of women from AVP to managing director levels at least to 40% globally. And that's up from 37% when we set the goal in 2018. And similarly, Black representation to 8% over the same period from 6%, which was the baseline in 2018. Our analyst and our associate program will have a 50-50 composition, 50% women and 50% men. And that obviously then requires that how we recruit, which campuses we go to, which universities and colleges we really go to. And the point you make, I think we are making a lot of progress. And our incoming CEO is a woman. And during the course of the conversation, I can touch upon a few more elements which tend to indicate the progress we are making as far as the gender diversity is concerned.
Yeah, I mean, it's thank you, Naveed. It's clear that financial services are doing huge amounts. And Oliver Wyman did a survey recently of very senior women and men in financial services. And it came back there as well that there is an increased management focus and management attention. So I think it's clear that organizations are doing a lot. However, this is a much harder challenge, and we find this as well at Oliver Wyman, for us to progress on than any of us had thought. So there is something that we're not quite getting right, or you know, it's a bigger challenge than we'd first thought. So Naveed, tell us, what are you struggling with? Which are the greatest areas of struggle when you think about gender, when you think about women of color in particular? You're a US organization, and the whole race question is, I think, very unique and more challenging in the US, bound up with societal challenges as well. So talk to us about what's difficult.
I think in order for us to improve the diversity in all its shades, I think it really needs a very sustained effort, and it needs leadership across the economic, social, and political domains. And it really requires to change the mindsets, behaviors, and attitudes towards diversity. Now, one of the most important things is that our leaders, they have awareness, they demonstrate conviction, and we don't treat diversity just as a societal issue. We treat diversity as a associated, because it has a very strong underlying economic logic, economic and business logic. So if we embrace diversity as a step towards achieving our business objectives and meeting some of our challenges, I think that's when, in my view, we will start making significant progress around this.
Thanks, Naveed. And you talk about leadership across economic, social, and political spheres, and strong leadership. And the 30% Club is absolutely coordinating across all of those. So Anne, you took on the global chair role, I think last year or this year.
I have enough to do, Rupal. I thought I'd do something else as well, you know.
Yes, earlier, officially mid this year, I think. And you've been very bold at launching a new strategy, very explicitly including all women in your focus, which hadn't been done before, and also broadening the UK targets to include race. So talk to us about What's been most challenging, particularly as you've taken, as you've broadened to think about race as well as gender in the UK?
Well, thanks. I want to just, you know, hook onto something that Naveed said, that if you actually think about changing this whole mix according to business drivers, then you're going to move forward much quicker and, you know, not just say, oh, we're trying to balance up society, et cetera. And I think that, you know, now we're in a business world which is managing many stakeholders, and there's a lot of data out there showing that companies that are truly diverse at the top are outperforming other companies. McKinsey publish this every year, many of the consultants do. So there is a business reason for doing this on a pure performance basis, but also on the ability to attract new customers, to appeal to customers, which I think is something that we've all talked about in the previous piece. In the 30% Club, we actually, you know, have made amazing progress in the UK from about 10% women on boards to 35% in the FTSE 100 now, and 33% in the FTSE 350. And the way this started was to just talk to the CEOs and chairmen of the companies and say to them, do you aspire to be a diverse company, and will you join us in actually signing goals to have at least 30% women on your boards? That is not the target, by the way, that's just the floor. Now, we found amazing support for that when the CEOs and the chairs signed up, because they were signing up for cultural change for their companies. Now, as you quite rightly pointed out, this year we're moving to actually include one person of colour on every FTSE 350 board as a target. And because we're the 30% club and have a gender lens, we've asked for a target of 50% of those seats to go to women of colour. Funnily enough, I had a call from some of the CEOs saying to me, Anne, I'm signing this, but are you for real? I mean, is that, you know, can I actually sign this and feel that I can achieve it? And I said, well, it's a collective goal, but you should know that we're already tracking to 42% women of colour in the seats that are occupied now. So everyone felt good about that. And people said to me, it was obvious for us to do the women thing. That's what the men said anyway, obvious. And then they said, but you know, now that we've seen the change with Black Lives Matter and so on, we're really glad the 30% Club has had the foresight to move this way. But you asked me about the challenges, Rupal, and one of my friends is a managing director at Morgan Stanley. She actually said to me, she's Black, and she said, you know, Anne, when you had all of these male chairmen and CEOs supporting women, they had wives, sisters, daughters that they could empathize with, they could think of as they were trying to diversify from a gender point of view. And she said, but they don't have necessarily the same kind of circles actually for Black people. So it might actually be harder for them to sort of think and aspire to this. Actually, I'm getting very positive response for them, so I don't think so, but this is something that we have to think about. And of course, in order to reach all of these women on boards and women at the top of the companies, you have to fix the pipeline underneath. And there's a lot of discussion today that the first rung on the ladder of that pipeline is quite broken. That's where the first step into real management positions, men accelerate, women stay stable, or sometimes they leave the company, and it can be to do with families. And we've been looking at that as well. And the best companies are actually addressing that in terms of their succession charts, in terms of their mentorship programs, and in terms of their training programs to see how to actually retain and grow their women workforce.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right, Anne. The survey that we did shows a huge increase in focus on race and on gender post the pandemic. And not less a focus on the other strands of diversity, but I'd love to hear from you, Amanda, because Aviva, again, leading the way on transparency, you've signed up to the race ratio, had a very clear action plan post Black Lives Matter, and you've really got this clear focus on race and on gender? And to what extent do you think we actually need to pick some diversity strands given limited management attention? And what do you say to people who say, well, what about all the other aspects of diversity? Is it a zero-sum game?
Look, I think that to just touch on some of the points that Anne has made there, I think this is, we've made progress at the most senior level. So I think, the Aviva board has 40% of women, and it has, we recently appointed our first ethnic minority board member. So I think that is brilliant. But unfortunately, I do think that the real challenge is where Anne said, which is right in the organization, at that point when you get your first leadership role, and that is at the point usually where, maternity happens, or there's parental care, because women tend to do more of that. So just focusing on gender for a second. And honestly, I think that all the training and all of that sort of stuff is just not enough, because I've seen so many unconscious bias training programs and succession plan sessions where we've all sat there and gone, oh, well, aren't we very good? We've got the women on the succession plan coming through, or we've got ethnicity on the succession plan, but it just doesn't happen. And I think for me, we have to address the fact that when women come back after they've had children or cared for parents, that they come back at the same level they leave the organization, and that the organization can, and not back into a more junior role where they feel they can cope with more flexibility. And that also that they can, that there is the opportunity to job share. I mean, at Aviva, we have, two really senior men actually in our sustainability role that have job shared for the last 4 years. It works absolutely brilliantly. I know this happens in the civil service well, but yet you do not see that very often through the organizations. And we've just got to do some more things rather than just talking about it. So why are we still having panels like this? Why is it still necessary to be talking about this? Why are there 1,300 people signed up today? Because everybody is just basically saying, we're all very good, but we can just go on forever. Get some stuff done. We don't need any more surveys to tell us that this is a problem. We need to actually do something about it. And look, I'm putting Aviva out there. My struggle is that I've moved from 27% to 32% women in leadership roles in the last 5 years. I've signed the Women in Finance Charter. I have to get to 40% by the end of next year. In order to do that, 80% of the people that I promote next year have to be women. 80%. And that is a major challenge that I'm looking at thinking, how am I going to do that and deal with all of the other things that there are? So I think it's really frustrating that it's taken us so long to get here. And 55% of people that start at entry level in insurance are women. And there's 21% of people on the board. And then if you look at the generalists, the P&L leaders, how many women are there? So few. Clearly something's going wrong. We've really got to fix that middle ground, I think. I think Anna's done a fantastic job at that top end. And I almost think now the momentum is there. How do we fix the middle of the organization?
Amanda, I just want to say, and since Naveed's here as well, that I was actually promoted on maternity leave when I was at Citi. But, I put that down to the fact I had an absolutely fabulous boss. And he just said to me, he was a man, of course, I've always had male bosses. He just said to me, Anne, I think you can take the next step now. I'm actually going to promote you. Come back to work. You're going to actually, the job you had are going to report into you. And it was a huge vote of confidence. And I think that, a lot of women would welcome that as well.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree. I mean, I took a new role whilst I had a pregnancy test in one hand and the job offer in the other. And I rang my future boss and said, I can't come. And he said, what? Why? And I did, but that doesn't, unfortunately, Anne, I think, I've gone through a lot of my career thinking, well, it's not been really a problem for me. But unfortunately, I think it is a problem for a lot of other people, don't you? And I think that, this is the point around, we need to make sure that there are supportive bosses and it's okay to take risks. That's perceived as being a risk. Of course, it's not a risk, but it is perceived as being a risk.
Naveed, I'd love to hear from you. You're a male boss who's supported women over the years. What are your perspectives on leadership and men supporting women through the pipeline?
If I illustrate the point through an example, So in the mid-90s, I was working with Saudi American Bank, which was affiliate of Citi in Saudi Arabia. And in order for us to achieve, and it's one of the largest banks in Middle East and still is. And in order for us to obviously achieve our business and growth objectives, as well as meet the regulatory target of building the local talent, meant that we had to hire more locals as well as talented locals. So when we started looking at the talent pool available in Saudi Arabia, we recognized that there is a very large pool of educated women locally or internationally who are not part of the mainstream professions because of the social and cultural constraints. So we came up what we called a social and cultural framework. And we went to the authorities, we got the approval, we started hiring women into executive cadres. And today, fast forward, obviously at that point in time, we've met our objectives, regulatory and obviously business growth. Today, the same bank is being run by a woman who is a chief executive officer in Saudi American Bank. Middle East, North Africa, which is Citi's cluster, is now being run by a woman. Our capital markets entity in Saudi Arabia is led by a woman. And we talked about our incoming CEO is a woman. This is exactly the point I was trying to make, which Anne also dwelt upon, that if you have a solution, you take diversity as a solution to your business objectives and challenges, it becomes a lot more easy to execute and make progress. And in my view, if you think about it, that was in mid-90s. And if you think about, at the time, it looked like a small step, but you look back, no step in the right direction is a small step. You have put in motion a generational process. And I gave you 3-4 examples. I can give you a lot more examples. And I think Amanda made a very good point, and I just want to develop on that a bit. I think it's very important that we broaden our imagination as leaders, how a leadership looks like. We often confuse style with leadership, and not able to recognize that there can be a wide range of styles for effective leadership. So effective leaders can be extroverts, they can be introverts, they can be understated. And these are gender, ethnicity, and cultural specific styles. And we also need to condition the organization to appreciate different styles of leadership so that we can process progress diversity. So prevalent view of the leadership is generally about a man as a reference point. And what you think about is fascinating that pre the Industrial Revolution, the self-help books in the Western economies emphasized character as a core of leadership. Guess what? Today, it emphasized personality as a core of leadership. And you know, the Amanda's point that why we are not making progress, consciously or unconsciously, we gravitate towards uniformity, and that actually defeats the purpose of diversity. And I have seen examples where if you have that notion of leadership, which is stereotypical, and then everyone consciously or unconsciously tries to emulate that, you have fundamentally defeated the purpose of diversity to begin with. Mm-hmm. So I think this education and awareness is extraordinarily important.
I think that the pandemic is influencing how we see leadership and has the potential to change the narrative around female leadership, We've seen some very strong female leaders, particularly at country level, if you think about Jacinta, Angela Merkel, and then we've talked about strong business leaders leading through the crisis, Jane, Amanda, the first female CEO in Aviva's 300 plus year history. But yet, I'd just like to put to the panel two data points. One is an Oliver Wyman report, which I think is not out yet, being written by some US colleagues, so look out for that one. But that shows that women and men see leadership differently and they value different things. And so if we have men promoting women or thinking about promoting women, but they don't value the leadership aspects that women bring, it explains why, in my view, we have many brilliant women who aren't making the progress that we would expect. Secondly, Andrew, perhaps Anne, you could talk about the Kantar study that you mentioned on perspectives of leadership, which paints a less rosy picture, Naveed.
Yeah, Kantar do an index every year that we discuss when we go to the Women's Political Leadership Forum in Iceland. And they ask people, how comfortable are you with women leaders? And actually, the results are showing that generally people are more comfortable with male leaders than female leaders, especially in the political sphere. And sadly, that, you know, the category, one of the categories that has the highest discomfort with women leaders is actually young men. So, you know, that's something that kind of makes us all think. I mean, it's certainly making me think. Mm. The other thing that's making me think, by the way, is, you know, what about the young leaders that are out there today? I mean, look at somebody like Greta Thunberg. You know, look at the following that some of these young leaders can create, and look at the platforms that they use to reach people, you know, Instagram, TikTok and things like this. They can actually move society in terms of the way that society thinks. So I think this is something else we should think about in our business models, about that style of leadership and what does that mean for the future? Because for sure the leaders of the future are going to be dealing with many different stakeholders. They're not there just to create a profit. They're there to create purpose for their company. They're there to deal with all of the different stakeholders. And they're the leaders that are going to have to help us survive climate change when we come out of COVID and allow us to be able to use 5G and artificial intelligence to augment ourselves in the way that's beneficial for society and ethical for society to use. So there are some big things coming out of that. Inez, you've just been working with the fintech areas and they're thinking about all of that, aren't they?
Yeah, no, sure. And I think, you know, one thought that struck me, I was reviewing some of the leaders in our network, and it's extraordinary, it's still down to individual women, really, to be the champions to make something happen. And I look at Simla Kamil in Pakistan, who was the first female CEO of a commercial bank there. She's now the deputy governor of the State Bank of Pakistan, and she's pushing financial inclusion for women. The same thing happens in Nigeria. The deputy governor came from Diamond Bank, where she pushed. It was the first commercial bank to take a strategic approach to the women's market. In a country where less than 10% of women have bank accounts, she's the deputy governor. I mean, we have to move beyond the point by point individual champion to look at the holistic, as you're saying, Anne. You are a company, we're all working in organizations that are part of a much bigger ecosystem. And we've got to bite the bullet here and say, a lot of women don't want to do the traditional corporate ladder. You know, I think you're gonna have a lot of trouble with the millennials. They're not gonna be interested in like working 15 hours a day for the same corporation for 30 years and making it to the top. It's a different ball game. People want to work in organizations that really add value to society. And I would say, you know, look at the women's market, look at the ethnic diversity in that marketplace, reflect that in your companies, but take a strategic approach, because it's not going to happen. We're still designing products for men. Look at the fintech space. Very few men in fintech, very few fintechs thinking about the women's market, when in fact it is the sector that can solve for the women's market. So, you know, I can't underestimate that. It is frustrating. I hear Amanda's frustration. It's still about individuals, and it has to be a much bigger agenda than that.
You know, can I just make a point? I think if you think about the business, economic, and social case for diversity, it has been long settled in favor of diversity, then the question becomes why we are not making progress. And I think my observation and research after research has suggested that historically, social, economic, and political systems are built around male as a default for humanity. And this is not a criticism. This is an ingrained inequality in our social, political, and economic systems. And unless, so if you think about, I'll just give you one example. Do you know when women are involved in a car accident, they're like the 47% greater likelihood for them to get seriously injured than men? Why is the case? Because cars are designed fundamentally for a male body. Up till 2011, they did not even have the accident testing dummies which will reflect the attributes, physical attributes of a woman. So I think what we are trying to do at Citi, amongst other things, we have set up a center for responsible leadership with Imperial College. And the idea here is to actually explore those built-in biases across spectrum of fields and create awareness among the leaders of today and the leaders of tomorrow. And I think it needs a lot of courage and imagination. And it's fascinating. I was reading a research which was published in Academy of Management Journal. It's quite extraordinary that it says that men, especially white men, are needed as champions of diversity in organizations because women and ethnic minority leaders can be penalized for engaging in diversity valuing behavior. White and male leaders are given a significant boost in their review ratings if they are engaged in diversity efforts. So my point is that it has to be led, and it's exactly in the point you were making, why it has to be just Amanda and Inns, or for that matter, Jane Fraser. It has to be everybody, of course, but particularly men, because they are in a greater position of influence and greater position of responsibility. Mm-hmm. And those are the things we are trying to do vis-a-vis, obviously, along a range of initiatives, particularly with our collaboration with Imperial College.
That sounds great, Naveed. You'll have to tell us all, you'll have to send us stuff out after this, Rupal, about a bit more about this whole Imperial College thing, because it sounds like something we would all like to engage on.
Absolutely. I think the future of leadership and the Center for Responsible Leadership and the partnership you have there sounds fascinating. I'd like briefly just to hear from you, Amanda, before we move to our next poll. You took on your CEO role during the pandemic, and Anne talked very powerfully about this, you know, virtual leadership and how younger leaders like Greta Thunberg are using different platforms to engage their people. How has it been for you leading 30,000 people through the crisis and not physically being able to go to York or to really meet them?
Yeah, no, I mean, it is different, that's for sure. I think, you know, normally, of course, as a leader, you get a real sense of the organisation as you walk around, don't you? And you sit at the side of people's desks, you go to the contact centres in York and Sheffield and Norwich, and you really get a feel of, is the culture good or not good? So you have to think about different ways of doing it. And, you know, do you know what? It's just been really good fun because we've been really creative about how we've done that. So we've created an Aviva radio station. We've got lots of Aviva, what we call Uncut, which is, you know, lots and lots of Q&A. We created, I don't know whether you watch Britain's Got Talent, probably not that many people on this call, right, where you have the video pictures of all the people in the organization, and we rolled out the whole strategy actually using that as a backdrop, and we had like 8,000-9,000 people on each strategy session with the ability to ask questions. And I think it's actually the fun bit of it has been using creativity and thinking about other ways, using a lot of polls and saying, you know, how are people feeling, because I'm really conscious that people are struggling. You know, I mean, I'm really worried about mental health. You know, there's no barrier between, there's no break between work and home now. People used to hate the commute, but now, you know, the commute from the bedroom to the kitchen table, it takes a lot shorter time, but it does mean that you're at your desk for a lot longer. You're, you know, back to back on calls. And the Zoom, the whole Zoom culture is very intense. You know, you're looking into somebody's eyes the whole time. You can't sort of look around, and you never get the opportunity to put your music on. I do think it is really intense, and we have to really, really think about that. So look, it's been brilliant fun. I think I'd like to go back to a little bit of a mixture of, you know, having people to some sort of physical concert and collaboration in the office. But the one thing I don't want is for us to go back to how we were before, which is, you know, everybody coming in just because they felt they had to. You know, we were able to put the whole organization to work from home within a week. Who'd have thought in February, if somebody had said you would have to do that, we'd have said no way, we can't do that. So I think we've shown what we're capable of, and now we need to ensure that we don't go back to the old ways. And because I think this could be the balance of a more collaborative and inclusive and a more agile environment, which would be better for everybody.
That's great. Thank you, Amanda. I'm going to ask Sarah, conscious of time, to launch our next poll. And as the participants fill in this poll, just to say, Oliver Wyman also did a survey of some senior members of the financial services industry. And to build on what you were saying, Amanda, in terms of not wanting to go back to the way that we were, and you're excited to get back to the office, that a number of them commented that they are seeing men return to the office at greater rates than women, and that they think that this will impact women's careers. We've also talked today about some of the long-term opportunities with more flexible working. So I think this poll, just read out now, is interesting because we're asking about the difference between the impact of the pandemic and whether it will negatively impact gender balance in the industry in the short term, but also the difference, the impact of the pandemic in the long term. And I'll be interested to see, Sarah, when we've got a decent number of responses, what our results say, and interested in the panelists' view, if anybody'd like to comment.
Tense waiting for the results, don't you think?
I didn't want to influence the results, but we'll go ahead and launch.
There you go.
So more negative in the short term, but actually, a majority for no for the long term, which I think is really interesting and mirrors the survey that we did of much fewer people before today's webinar. So that's very positive to think that actually there are opportunities for us. But I think what we shouldn't do, Amanda, as you said powerfully, and all of our panelists have, is lull ourselves into a false sense of security that we will magically go from that short term to the long term. You often find when you ask people, you know, when will we have gender balance in the world, some of those sort of UN goals in the long term, people, and we did this very powerfully at an event last year, people say, oh, you know, in 15-20 years. So when it's the long term and you don't really have to think about it, it doesn't feel that far away. But we've been facing this challenge for more than you know, more than a couple of decades, actually. So I'd now like to talk to our panelists with just for some closing statements. And, you know, as we look forwards and we really think about what we can do, this panel has come up with lots of really great ideas that we'll write up afterwards. But I'd like to ask the same question of each of our panelists, which is, what is the single most impactful action that we should be focused on to improve gender balance in financial services? And Inez, perhaps we can come to you first.
I think women care about values, and I think if they saw their companies really supporting women in the community, they are more likely to be engaged. So I would encourage you to take a strategic approach to the women's market, to understand it and to win in the market, and I think that will help you internally.
Thank you. Amanda?
For me, it's really quite straightforward. Let's take the benefits of COVID, which have been a more flexible and more agile response, and make sure that we do not go back to the old days of presenteeism and 9 to 5 in the office, which I think works against women. I think this new working environment can be really positive for women.
Thanks, Amanda. And Naveed?
Yeah, you know, I will agree with Amanda that sometimes when you have an unfortunate event like COVID-19, it does give you impetus to move the world in the right direction. So this, what it has really told us that we can actually work beyond the traditional ways of working. And I think that does give flexibility to attract diversity. But I think overall, my point is we have to take diversity as a solution or one of these solutions to meet the challenges and leverage the opportunities. And this is the high road which is going to take us to meet those challenges and opportunities. And I think it's absolutely critical. It is not a societal issue anymore. It is a mainstream economic and business issue.
Well, Oliver Wyman sized the opportunity for women as customers as $900 billion before the pandemic. We haven't refreshed the numbers, but that's arguably the single greatest growth opportunity for the financial services market, where growth is pretty thin on the ground at the moment. Anne, I'd love to hear from you about the single greatest action that we should be focused on.
Well, I think it's absolutely being transparent about what the issue is that you're trying to solve. Amanda gave us a great example about the number of people, women, that she'd have to promote to actually get that 40% target reached. I think you have to set a target, be transparent about it, say what you have to do to change it, use the data to tell you what you have to do to change it, and then take that very bold step in that direction. Naveed had said earlier that, you know, one step in the right direction can change everything. Absolutely, one small step per man, a huge step for mankind. We may have to change the man bit in that, but I think that's absolutely the way to do it.
I love that.
Well, just to close us out, someone said to me last week, inch by inch, life is a cinch, yard by yard, life is hard. So perhaps it's one step at a time. So while the short term can seem a bit depressing, I think what the panel have really summarised is that this time, more than any, we have so many options for the future, and having global leaders such as our panel today committed to driving this agenda really gives me great hope for our industry. We'll be back in the new year with Alison Rose and also a short op-ed to continue the conversation. Oliver Wyman, the 30% Club, and I hope you don't mind me speaking on behalf of Citi, Mastercard, Aviva, the Financial Alliance for Women, we are committed to driving change in our industry of financial services. Please do join our community, connect with us on LinkedIn, follow us on Twitter, and let's continue to drive positive change in our industry. Thanks everyone for your time.
Thanks everybody.
Thanks panelists.